Hi everybody, my name's Hunter. I'm a teaching assistant for the class Biology 2605, Marine Life of Nova Scotia at Dalhousie University. And I wanted to put together this video showcasing some of the marine invertebrates that you can find around Nova Scotia. All the footage in this video is mine, unless otherwise credited. Some images are from a paper or two. But it's mostly all my own footage, and I just wanted to do this sort of as a fun little educational thing and as a way to show people what they've got in their own backyards. If you like the video, feel free to show it to your class if you're watching this or seen it on Twitter or something like that, and feel free to follow me on Twitter. It's @bellistomatid. Thank you guys, and let's get into it. I'm going to start off by talking about one of the most fascinating groups of organisms that I've seen out here, and that's the ctenophores, or the comb jellyfish. They come in a bunch of different shapes and sizes that you can see here in this figure from Tamm 2014, such as the cydipid body form with the oval body and two long tentacles, and the cigar comb jellies, which are usually represented by Baroa. They can come in a whole bunch of these different kinds of shapes, even benthic forms that live on the ocean floor. But I'm going to typically talk about cydipids and cigar comb jellyfish because that's what I see around here most of the time. So let's talk about ctenophores. They're currently thought to be the second oldest lineages of animals in our evolutionary history, appearing during the Cambrian period about 525 million years ago. Despite the name comb jellyfish, they're actually a totally separate phylum from the cnidarians, the phylum that includes corals and what we would call true jellyfish. This is the first species of ctenophore I ever encountered in Nova Scotia, a cydipid called Pleurobrachia pileus, or the sea gooseberry. You can see here that unlike typical jellyfish, it moves by beating what's called comb rows of cilia, small hair-like projections. It uses those two long tentacles to capture prey, and unlike cnidarian jellyfish, comb jellyfish don't possess the venomous stinging nematocyst cells that on their tentacles. Rather, they possess special sticky cells called colloblasts that ensnare small prey such as larval invertebrates in fish and other zooplankton. To my understanding, ctenophores are actually quite voracious predators of larval animals, and one species of the genus Nemeopsis is actually invasive in the Black Sea, where it is being implicated in certain fishery collapses because it eats so many larval fish. The first time I ever encountered Pleurobrachia was on a real cold day in November, and I actually didn't have my GoPro yet. When I entered the water, I swear I was in an aggregation of over 1,000 of them, and they were just shimmering away. I was with one of my lab mates, Daniela, who was watching me from shore, and I was so desperate to film them that I yelled at her to throw me my water bottle so I could capture a few to bring back. Here you can really see that they actually swim really well and have exceptional control over their locomotion. Oh, I want to apologize too. I film on a GoPro, and one of the drawbacks to using those as video cameras is that there's no viewfinder, so I just kind of have to point and pray that whatever I'm filming is centered and in focus. I'll upgrade my camera one day, but for now I'm just a poor grad student. So I've mentioned that cydipid ctenophores use sticky rather than stinging tentacles to catch their prey, but unlike true jellyfish that have a ton of tentacles, cydipids only have two. So how do they efficiently capture their prey? This clip of an Arctic comb jelly, Mertensia ovum, shows you how. Watch closely. I've sped up the process here, but remarkably those cydipid tentacles can be unwound to form a sticky plankton ensnaring net. Seeing these things with their nets out in the sunlight is really one of my favorite sights when I'm out snorkeling. Those nets are just gorgeous. Now I'm going to talk about my personal favorite comb jelly, Baroa. Baroa? Also, you'll have to forgive me if I'm pronouncing things wrong. I'm from Saskatchewan and I never learned about these organisms formally. Everything I know is actually from my own reading, and so I've never said a lot of these words out loud before. Anyways, these ctenophores can get pretty big and gorgeous. That violet color coupled with the shimmering cilia is absolutely beautiful in person. However, you might be wondering how and what Baroa eats without any tentacles to catch its prey. And the answer lies in how kissable it is. Yes, you heard me. Kissable. Let's all just take a moment to admire these luscious ctenophore lips. One day I'll give one a smooch and I'll report back what it's like, you know, for science.
Trying to hold back and feeling for so long. And if you feel...
On second thought, maybe I won't. This is a microscopic look at the modified cilia on Baroa's lips. Remember our original question of how does Baroa eat? Well, here's the answer. It might be a surprise. Gone! Wasn't there another ctenophore there a second ago? Baroa is actually a predator of other ctenophores, especially our friend Pleurobrachia pileus. Speaking of predators, here's one that eats all of our lovely ctenophores. This is the lion's mane jellyfish, Cyania capillata. These start to appear in June when the water gets warmer and become very common throughout the rest of the summer. It's an example of how populations of animals fluctuate seasonally and the top-down control of populations by a predator. Once these jellyfish become common in our waters, the ctenophores practically vanish. Lion's mane jellyfish are actually one of the largest species of jellyfish in the world, and some individuals have been known to get a bell, that's the squishy bit, of over 6 feet across and tentacles of over 100 feet long. That puts them up right up there with the blue whale and one of the longest animals known to us. However, they aren't really dangerous to humans, and their sting is apparently quite mild. I don't intend to find out, though, and I'm only confident when I get close to these animals because I have very little exposed skin since I wear a wetsuit, gloves, and hood. Although part of me hates them for eating up all the ctenophores, they're very pretty in their own right and have an important role in our ecosystem as both predator and prey for other organisms. Okay, now we're getting into the real weird stuff. One day I was snorkeling and came across this thing. I didn't really make too much of it until later, when I encountered its parent. This was the first time I'd ever seen anything that I truly had no idea of what it might be, and just as I was getting lined up to film it, I got attacked by the most aggressive invertebrate in our waters, the Baltic isopod. These crustaceans are really funny, assuming they don't freak you out, because I think they hate being exposed in the water column, so they'll usually grab onto some dislodged kelp. I don't think they can tell the difference though, so they try to hang on to the odd snorkeler that they find, and disturbingly, one time I was at the beach and one fell out of my swimming trunks. Even I have my limits, man. Anyways, after chasing the isopod off, I got a better look at this creature, and thanks to Professor Frail Gauthier, who identified a really grainy Twitter video for me, I learned that this is a siphonophore called Nanomia cara. Siphonophores are actually colonial organisms, which means the whole individual is comprised of specialized individual animals. Multicellularity is honestly weird and I don't really understand it, but yeah, it's colonial. Kind of a communist animal, I guess. But I digress. You can see the head, or pneumatophore, is made up of sacs called nectophores. And by expelling water, the siphonophore uses these sacs to swim, and it actually does it really efficiently. The long tail is how it reproduces. Those are actually baby siphonophores that grow and split off from the parent in a form of reproduction called budding. I believe that this is the rarest animal I've actually ever seen snorkeling. The literature I've read states that they are open ocean dwelling animals, and not only that, but they usually dwell hundreds of meters deep and as a consequence are rarely seen alive. In fact, there's only one other YouTube video of this species, and it's an individual from Norway. You truly never know what you're going to find when you jump into the water, and that's why I love Nova Scotia. Moving into some more colorful characters, what you're looking at is not, in fact, a sperm, but a worm. This is a polychaete worm. Specifically, it is the epitoke of a polychaete worm. Usually, these worms can be found in the nooks and crannies of the shore, but when it comes time to reproduce, they undergo a transformation called epitoche and become free-swimming. Some polychaetes take this to the next level and bud off epitokes, similar to what that siphonophore I talked about before does. It's kind of like if you could just detach your junk and it makes its own Tinder profile and you don't have to worry about actually meeting new people. I wish I could do that. These are epitokes of Elida verens, sometimes called the king ragworm. One thing about polychaetes is that unlike other annelid worms, you should most definitely not touch or pick these guys up. A lot of polychaetes have chitinous pincers that they can use to bite offensively or defensively, and the parapodia of some polychaetes can be used to deliver a venomous sting. They're very pretty, but like everything you see in nature, it's best observed from a distance and not disturbed. Well, I should practice what I preach a little bit better, because I do kind of tease this guy a bit. This is a shrimp from the genus Palaemon. No, not the demon from Hereditary, that's Paimon. I just love the way this little guy is running on the air. One of the interesting things in this clip is actually the substrate. If you look at it closely, you'll realize it's made up of tons of dead snails. These shrimp are scavengers, so it's a perfect place for them to feed and hide. Often, shrimp of this genus are what you wind up having on your plate for dinner if you've ordered prawns. Sorry I'm so shaky in this clip, too. It's at the end of a snorkel trip, and I'm getting pretty cold and shivering. One of my favorite things about crustaceans is that, honestly, a lot of them have different personalities. This Jonah crab was not at all a fan of me getting close, and scared me so bad that I dropped my camera. One fun fact about crustaceans is that the body form of the crab has evolved several times over evolutionary history in a phenomenon termed carcinization. So for example, hermit crabs aren't really considered true crabs taxonomically. This implies that the crab body form is evolutionary perfection. And this has led some evolutionary biologists to theorize that crabs may be the ultimate life form, and it may not in fact be long before they launch an attack on humanity. I'm not worried though. Most crabs are happy to just pose for my camera and do their crabby thing. Remember what I said about crustaceans having personality? This Jonah crab is shy and just wants me to go away as soon as I can. Meanwhile, this other one over here, its neighbor, actually seems a little curious. Oh, and a quick quiz for my students. What's that chlorophyte algae behind it? Yep, dead man's fingers, Codium fragile. My favorite. And of course, it wouldn't be a video about the marine life of Nova Scotia if it didn't have this iconic species. Homarus americanus, the American lobster. This huge one is actually pretty special. It's a rare blue lobster, and the odds of one being born are 1 in 2 million, and it's even rarer for one to get this big. A fun fact about lobsters is that they're functionally immortal. They don't really age the same way that we do. The things that often wind up killing them is actually the limits of physics. Because they have an exoskeleton, they need to keep going through the molting process, where they shed their old exoskeleton to make room for the new one growing underneath over their entire life. Once they reach a certain size, the surface area of the shell just becomes too stressful to shed effectively, and they die from complications of molting. Between being immortal and having the ultimate body form, crustaceans really do have it all. The lobster fishery is also extremely valuable to Nova Scotia, with an estimated annual catch valued at about $500 million. Thankfully, I hear from my friends that study their populations that our populations are quite healthy too. And even though it's just anecdotal evidence, when I see lots of lobsters of different sizes like this on my snorkeling trips, it gives me peace of mind to know that they'll be around for the years to come. So while you're enjoying watching those two lobster at the bottom square up with each other, I just want to say thank you for watching, and I truly hope you've learned something. Thank you too to our coordinator Isabel, and thank you Professor Frail Gauthier and Claude Nozeres for helping me to identify some of these crazy critters. I hope that this video has made you want to get out and explore your neighborhood water body. There's nothing out there that I think is more enjoyable than jumping in the water and discovering all these wonderful creatures we share our existence with. So if you have any questions about getting started with snorkeling, feel free to send me a DM on Twitter or something like that. That's all from me for now, so thanks again, and be safe!